schedule. It was Tim's turn to open, but I forgot to tell him. So.
I'm always ready. I'm always ready, so it's not.
You turn your next one.
But that's all right. So I was talking to my mother this morning. I don't know what's going on, but I feel like I'm being pulled from two different directions. And this has been going on for a while. Something happens and I get really excited, and then all of a sudden I feel this, I don't care anymore, you know? And I don't know what's going on, seriously, because I'm not sad. I'm not depressed. I'm not angry. I'm angry about anything. It's just this constant up and down, yeah. And I don't know where this is coming from. Is the Lord trying to tell me something and the devil is pulling me in the other direction because he doesn't want me to hear it? Maybe. I don't know. But it's really hard. Being alone all the time, and I think that has to do in part with what's going on. So I was talking to my mother this morning, and I told her, you know, pray for me because I feel like I'm in this hole that I'm trying to get out, and I advance 2 feet, but someone throws dirt in my face, and I slide back down. And it's been going on, so she started asking me some questions. Is it emotional? Is it personal? And all this stuff. I said, just don't worry about it. Just pray for me, and, you know, praise God for mothers because He uses them in the best way possible.
Yeah. Yep. Amen.
And she sent me this scripture, and I want to share it with you. Psalm 61, verses 1 through 4. Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I call for you. I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy. Let me dwell in your tent forever. Let me take refuge under the shelter of your wings. Whatever it is that's going on, I know God's going to take me through it. If you can pray for me, I would. So I'm just standing in His word, whatever He said to me that's going to happen, I know it's going to happen, and I'm just going to completely ignore whatever the devil has been trying to do to get me to feel. going to happen this Friday. And speaking about that, Mike, what you shared about supernatural worship, the Lord gave me a word about that, but I want to share it with you first because I want to discuss it with you and then share it on Friday when we're here. Yeah. But yeah, it's like you said, all these things that are happening.
Yeah. It's just,
it's because
heaven and earth will pass away, but his word's not passed away.
Right, right.
So it's settled. It is established. And the other thing, talking about being in a hole and dirt being thrown on you, ever hear the old story about the hole they tried to bury?
most of them are starting from zero, mm-hmm. and they're starting in Revelations. So I was talking to the pastor, and although like it is and like it was for us, it's very difficult to understand, and it can be very confusing and very frightening. Mm-hmm. I'm going to try to bite my tongue, but I want boldness and discernment to be able to throw my two cents in about his grace and how awesome he is in the appropriate times, so that those seeds can be planted in their lives that they never would have gotten otherwise. So strength for me and wisdom to know when to speak up and when to hold my tongue, right? And hopefully be a blessing to everyone at that Bible study.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
Sunday. Okay, we prayed for Tiffany's mom Sunday. She was hospitalized. She was unresponsive. Something with leukemia. Shaley's with Tiffany right now at the hospital, talking to her mother. Mm-hmm. So the prayers were answered, and she's on a breathing machine right now. But God did touch her. Not too right around the time we prayed for her. A little bit after we prayed for her. Her mom became responsive and stuff, so Shaley relays thanks, and Tiffany naturally does also, so
Amen.
Just keep lifted up for total recovery, and I believe her mom is going to be touched, and the Lord is already speaking to her right now through those girls.
Yes.
So.
Amen.
Whatever it takes.
Sentence, and I told him we pray.
that resolved. Fresh breath from heaven. So we can have our system. Amen. Amen. Jesus.
See her cry, but she's very, very disturbed. I prayed with her, you know, told her, let me know if we can help her daughter, if we can help her husband. That's all I know to do. There's a guy sitting out here on the porch when he came in, too. So let's pray for him. He says he's homeless, he's in the park. So I was trying to talk to him a little bit before he came in, too. And I'm sure Nathan sees him. I asked if he's talked to Pastor. He says, yeah, a couple times.
Circumstances of our lives to change them so that they are fixed and they operate according to your will and purpose for our lives. Father, I declare right now the healing on those that are in need of healing. Whatever situation it is, whether it's cancer, whether it's back problems, breathing problems, Lord, or responsiveness, everything right now, Lord, is gone and it's healed in your name, Jesus. Father, we pray for the provision that you give us. I declare the provision on the lives of all of those that are in need of a financial breakthrough. They're able to support themselves because you are providing for them, Lord, as you always do. Father, I declare that you are mending all the relationships that are strained, that are broken. People that have worked together in your name that have parted ways, I declare right now, Lord, that they are coming back together. And everything, Lord, thank you. was going to make a funny comment, but I'm not going to say anything. I'm going to say it. I'm excited because hockey season starts today.
There you go.
Anyway, this this Friday we have our Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Yep.
Hebrews 12 is written all over it. Continue to listen to what the Lord is going to put in your hearts to be released in this place. If you can come, it is an awesome time. Excuse me. Do you have anything to add?
No, I've had several people who normally don't come inquire, so just prepare the place. Okay. Receive them in.
Amen.
Brother Tim, as the Holy Spirit leads, I'm going to step it up and play because I know you get a big stick.
It's home runs to get back.
Hallelujah. It's
going to
be good.
Oh, yeah. Can't wait. All right. Speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Toby, would you mind taking the offering? Let's give John a break because he's got the grandbaby.
I know it's been a little bit different since I came back from my weekend with the Lord. It's really cool how things are going, and just like right now, it feels like the last time I was at Drake Relays or at State, I can't remember, but it was always running high hurdles and stuff, and the anticipation, waiting to get to the starting line. The starting line, you can't tell I ran hurdles, but I did. Anyway. Just waiting for that gun to go off, that anticipation. Just sitting on the skirmish line, like you're talking about, Tim, when you were playing football and stuff, just being right there on that line, right there on that line, just waiting for the snap of the ball or the gun to go off. It's just like right now, it's just like right there.
And, you know, I have a choice to be nervous or I have a choice to listen carefully to that, that fire off of that gun and stuff. So I just love the Lord. And remembering back from day one of my hurdle coach back in junior high saying, half the race is the start. Half the race is the start. How you get out of those blocks is how you start. And God's already moving in this place, so the gun's already going off. We just need to pick up the pace and roll with it. So, hallelujah. 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 It's fun to do without a sound guy, but, you know, we're going to just trust with the Lord. So, you ready, James? Are you ready, James? Ready? Okay. One, two, three, four.
We glorify, we glorify that night, our sovereign Lord is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. The Spirit of the sovereign God is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. He has sent you to the poor. This is the year to bind up the brokenhearted. This is the day to bring freedom to the captive. Release the ones in darkness. This is the year. Oh, the favor of the Lord.
This is the day
of the vengeance of our God.
This is the year.
Oh, the favor of the Lord. Of the vengeance of our God. The Spirit of the sovereign Lord is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach good news. The Spirit of the sovereign God is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach good news. He will comfort all who mourn. He will provide for those who grieve in Zion. He will pour out his oil of gladness.
This is the year.
Instead of mourning, he will pray.
This is the year
of the favor of the Lord. Of the vengeance of our God.
This is the year
of the favor of the Lord.
This is the day,
because our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. We acclaim his power and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God
God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Awesome God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. He is awesome. Praise God. He put the awe in awesome. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I know how that word has become pretty popular, you know, that's awesome, this is awesome, that's awesome.
God is awesome.
That God is awesome. Yeah. Amen. He'll drop your jaw. Amen.
Yeah.
He'll make you, what? Because He is an awesome God. Amen. Praise God. God bless all of you. Thank you for being here tonight. Appreciate your testimonies and prayer requests. Thanks for including us and allowing us to be a part of what God's going to do. Be the first time. All right. But anyhow, so it takes some time and it takes some effort on our part to discern the voice of God or to get to where we can actually be led by the Spirit in that sense. So that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. And, you know, because God deals with us by the Spirit. Now think about it. What He created new in us, what was a recreated about us is our spirit. Our flesh didn't change. Now, over time, hopefully we can do some things to discipline and, you know, just based on what the Word of God says.
Right.
But what got transformed, what got changed was our spirit. And the reason it was transformed was so that we could be one with God, so that we can interact with God. Because before we were enemies of God, aliens, separate from God. Amen. And so it's only natural then, pardon the pun, not unintended, but that the enemy would try to get us into the natural, into the carnal. I mean, we use that word carnal and carnality as though it's all bad. It's not necessarily evil or sinful. It can be, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. It can just be being natural, just being a human. So the enemy has to get us into that natural state, into that carnal mind, in order to hinder us from being led by the Spirit. So it's important. One of the reasons for the recreated Spirit, of course, it's to unify us with God, to make us one with God, to have us born in His image, but it's also because it's how God communicates, by the Spirit. God is a Spirit. Under the Old Covenant, the Spirit came on people. The New Covenant, the Spirit dwells within us. So God used to speak externally to people. Everything had to be an outward thing because they were carnal.
Right, right.
They did not have the Holy Ghost. They were not spiritual people.
Right.
Contrary to what some people might believe, they were not spiritual. They may have been well disciplined. They may have had, you know, motives for doing things based on what God's Word told them, but they were not spiritual people.
Right.
That's why it didn't take any faith, amen, to live under the Old Covenant. It just took discipline. It took hard work. It took effort. Under the New Covenant, the work part has all been done by Jesus, and now we operate by the Spirit. We're led by the Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Based on the finished work of the cross. All right? So let's begin. I want to go to Job chapter 29, and I want to read the first four verses of Job 29. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. Moreover, Job continued his parable and said, "Oh, that I were as in months past, as in the days when God preserved me, when His candle shined upon my head, and when by His light I walked through darkness, as I was in the days of my youth, when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle." Now, let's read it again because I want you to get this focus. We're going to go back to this several times this evening, but I want you to see what's going on here. Moreover, Job continued his parable, and he said, Oh, that I were as in months past, as in the days when God preserved me. When his candle shined upon my head, and when by his light I walked through darkness, as I was in the days of my youth, when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle. All right, now let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we'll read verses 11 through 15. 1 Corinthians 2, 11 through 15. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man, which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. Praise the Lord. So, as I said, I don't know if I said it to you, but I was talking to Tammy earlier, and Job is a prophetic book. It's not just a historic book. It's not just about the trials of a man, but it's prophetic. It's a prophetic book, which all of the Bible is, but I think sometimes we get hung up in Job and see it more from a carnal mind, if you will. That just kind of shows all the bad stuff that can happen to a person, amen? But it's actually a very prophetic book. Because under the Old Covenant, as I said, the Holy Spirit was only on the prophets. It only came on the kings and the priests and the prophets. Amen? And of course, we have a better covenant, right? We have the Holy Spirit in us, dwelling in us. He'll never leave us or forsake us. He's with us. He is in us. Amen? So let's look at now Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 27. Thank the Lord. Amen. The spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly, the inner part of man, the heart or the spirit of man. So the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. So let's just look at this for a minute. The spirit of man is what God uses. It's the candle of the Lord, right? That's how he brings revelation. That's how he brings light, amen, is to the spirit of man. My spirit is God's light. It's God's candle, amen, searching all the inward parts of the belly. Praise the Lord. All right, now let's go back to Job chapter 29 and verse 1 through 4 again. Moreover, Job continued his parable and said, Oh, that I were as in months past, as in the days when God preserved me, when his candle shined upon my head, and when by his light I walked through darkness. Amen. Praise the Lord. Verse 3, when his candle shined upon my head. It wasn't in him. It was on his head. Amen. It just shined upon him. Amen. And then verse 4, upon my tabernacle. Not in it. Amen. Not in him, but on him. Amen. So the Holy Spirit is in our human spirit, yes, so that we can receive the things of God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 through 10. The Holy Spirit isn't just so we can speak in tongues or so that we can go to heaven in the rapture. The Holy Spirit is in us so that we can know the things of God, so that we can relate to God, so that we can understand God when he speaks to us, when he relates to us, amen? We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God.
Right.
All right? So what spirit searches all things? Before you answer, I'll tell you. It's the human spirit. If you read this in context, why would the Holy Spirit need to search the things of God? The Holy Spirit is God.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. He already knows everything about God.
Yeah.
He already knows the things of God. Amen? So the Holy Spirit of God is already knows the things of God. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Praise the Lord. It sounds like a contradiction. Because the next verse, verse 10, says God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. So who can know, right? Who can understand this? Because it's unknown to the natural mind, amen. But it did enter into his heart, or into the heart, into the spirit of the man. But it came by his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, into the human spirit. I don't want to. I hope I'm not confusing you here, but I'll just keep moving on. But I want you to understand, our human spirit searches the inner parts of us to understand God. And it does it by the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit's within us, right? Paul said in verse 13 that we compare spiritual with spiritual, right? So the natural eye hasn't seen, the natural ear hasn't heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man through the five senses. That's what he's setting us up there for the context. Natural eye hasn't seen it. Natural ear hasn't heard it. Neither has it been felt. Why? Because it doesn't come by the senses. It doesn't come by the five senses. It comes by the Spirit of God. It didn't come by seeing. It didn't come by hearing. It didn't come by smelling. It didn't come by tasting. It didn't come by feeling. God revealed it to us by his Spirit. It came by the Spirit of God into our human spirit. Amen? This is what we do, this is what we talk about, renewing of the mind, is to get our mouth into agreement with God's Word.
Yes.
Now, our spirit is totally accepting of the Word of God. It never questions it. Why? Because it's one with God.
Yeah, right.
It innately recognizes the truth of God's Word,
yes,
which is all revelation. So any revelation, obviously, that's true revelation is based on the Word of God. Has to come out of the principles of God's Word. And we know it innately. Not by our intellect, not by what when we read it on the page, but by internally, our spirit immediately recognizes. Why? Because the words that Jesus speaks are spirit and they're life. They're not just knowledge. It's not just information. It is all revelation. It's all spiritual realities. Amen? It doesn't come by seeing, hearing, or anything else. It comes to us by the Spirit of God. Amen? So look at this. Psalms 112. And verse 4. Unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion. That is not it. Psalms 112 and verse 4. Hallelujah, Jesus. Unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness, and he is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. Praise the Lord. So, God's Word is a lamp unto our feet and a light to our path. All right? Now let me just share this with you, okay? Let's go to John chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. He said, I am the true vine, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring more fruit. All right? That word purgeth is in the concordance, it is 2508. That's the number. It is kathahuta. And it means, we've always believed that it meant to cut off, to trim back. But remember, this was written to Jews 2,000 years ago.
Right.
And that word literally translates, and you can look it up for yourself, cleanse. So, because the way they pruned in those days was with water. They didn't cut things back. They washed the pollens, the insects, and so on and so forth off of the vines, right? Because look at verse 3 here. And you can see the context, right? Now ye are clean through the word, which I have spoken unto you. Right? Now look at verse 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it will be done unto you. Why? Because you have been cleansed. Praise the Lord. And now you are clean. Acceptable. And you can, based on that, you can come to God and ask whatever you will, and it'll be done unto you. Praise the Lord. All right, let's go a little further with this. John chapter 13 and verse 10. Remember this? Jesus is going to wash his disciples' feet. Peter, being Peter, says, oh no, you're not washing my feet. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you're not any part of me. He said, okay, wash all of me. She said, you don't need to be. All of you doesn't need to be washed. Just your feet. Right? If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will. Okay. 13 verse 10. Jesus saith unto him, he that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit, and ye are clean, but not all. Now, that he's talking about Judas. But think about it. This is exactly what he was just saying that we just read. He's saying, you've been cleansed, right? You've been cleansed. But you need something every day to maintain that. Not so that... you're not going to be lost, right? But in order to understand, in order to walk in the truth, you need to wash your feet every day. What is it? It's by the washing of the water of the Word. That's what I'm saying to you, and that's where that fits into what I'm talking about here today. If you've been born again, you're as clean as you're ever going to get. But you get born again by the Word of God, right? And so to maintain that existence, to operate in that reality, you need to constantly be going back to the Word of God to tell you who you are, to tell you how you can pursue and receive and benefit from everything that God has for you. That's the metaphor he's using here, is to wash feet, right? So he says this, faith cometh by hearing. And hearing by the Word of God. It's a continuous verb, if you will. It isn't like faith comes by having heard. Faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing. That's the washing of the feet. Everything else is good. You don't need to be washed again. You've been cleansed. You've been made whole. But you do need the washing of the water of the Word, and you need it on a regular basis in order for you to remember and understand who you are and what you can expect God to do for you, because God's going to speak to you fundamentally and primarily through His Word.
Yes.
Now, if you get a revelation, that revelation is going to be in the Word. How many of you have read Scripture over and over and over and over, and you understood what it said, but then one day, out of the clear blue, something happens, and you read that Scripture, and you go, oh, my God, I never saw that. The Word didn't change. Amen? But you just got a revelation. The Spirit has spoken to your spirit, and now you've gotten more than just what was on the surface of that page. Now it has become a living Word. Now it becomes a reality. It's more than just something profitable to do, something, you know, that you should discipline yourself to do it. All of a sudden, now it becomes alive. Amen. It's life-changing. Amen. So we're saved. We don't need anything else for us to be saved, but we need the Word regularly, to go back to the original text, if we want to bear fruit. If we're going to produce what God has declared is in us, we have to do it by the Word of God, because God is going to speak to us through His Spirit. Amen. That's revelation. Okay, let's go again to Job chapter 29, verse 4 this time. And again, as it was in the days of my youth when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle. Again, upon it, not in it. Now look at the language that's used in the New Testament. John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But you know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. Amen. So God reveals things to your spirit. It's revealed from within, not through the senses. You have to learn to trust the Spirit. That's the reason, that's the main reason for reading the Bible. Not just so you can quote Scripture, but so that when the Spirit of God speaks to you, you have a reference point. Right? I mean, come on, let's face it. Over the years, people have done all kinds of wacky stuff in the name of religion. Right? Well, God told me to do it. No. He didn't tell you to do something that's contrary to the Word of God. Now, if He told you something by the Spirit, it's here somewhere. It's in His Word. Because He's not going to contradict His Word. He's not going to ask you or tell you to do something that isn't in agreement with His Word.
Right.
He can't.
Right.
He'd be schizophrenic. Yep. That's the reason why we preach. That's the reason why we read the Bible. That's why we meditate on the Word of God. Because God wants to speak to our spirit. God is speaking to us. I guarantee you, God is speaking to you every day. But because we're not confident that it's God, amen, we wonder. And that opens the door for the enemy to come in and say, well, that was just you. You just want this really bad. And look, but the Bible says He witnesses with our spirit, His Spirit witnesses with our spirit, that we may have the things of God. So that we'll know what those things are so that we can ask what we will and receive it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 12. We have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. So we've received not the spirit of the world, not the natural spirit of man, but the Spirit which is of God, so that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. God gave you His Spirit. Why? So that you can know what you have, so you won't walk in darkness.
Right.
Let's think about this. He gave you His Spirit so that you can know that by His stripes you were healed. Right? Otherwise, if you don't know that, and many, many Christians don't, they don't believe it.
Right?
They're in darkness. They're still in darkness when it comes to healing.
Right?
He gave you His Spirit so that you would know that He became poor that you might become rich. Why? So you don't walk in darkness and accept poverty.
Right.
When you have within you prosperity, everything you set your hand to prospers.
Yes.
The enemy comes and tells you, no, 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 no. It's based on the job you've got, the hourly wage, the monthly wage, the whatever it might be. That's your source. That's your income. No, it is not.
No.
God is our source.
Yes.
And He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think.
Yes.
Amen. We heard testimonies here today. Look, most people faced with situations like with Tim and Leah. They listen to the lawyer. The lawyer's, well, it's not looking good. You know, you're probably going to have to do this, and this is going to happen, and that's going to happen. But something in their spirit said, we don't have to settle for that.
Right.
We have a God who is more than able to deliver us in any situation, under any circumstances, and He's more than, not just is He able to, He is more than willing to. He wants to show Himself mighty on our behalf. Amen. He wants to be glorified. He wants to be declared righteous, holy, good,
yes.
Amazing,
yeah.
Awesome,
yes.
Because He is.
Yes.
Now, he put something in their spirit that said, we can expect this.
Exactly.
We can believe for this. Right? It didn't come by the intellect. The mind would tell you every reason not to believe that. And they had plenty of opportunities, and all of us have. I'm just using them as an example. Over the course of time, there were plenty of times when you could have said, this is just going nowhere. It's not going to work. Yeah. I mean, I remember you talking about going to the home, and they're not letting her hear anything from the Bible or study the Word of God or receive anything from God. I mean, a lot of people would have just said, well, you know, how's this going to work then? Yeah. How's she ever going to get past where she's at if she can't get the Word into her? But something in their spirit had a witness from God's spirit that they don't control everything.
Right.
They may think they do. They can make all the rules they want. But he's still king.
Right.
He's still the King of Kings. He's still the Lord of Lords. He can still do whatever he wants to do. Amen. For his children, for his people. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. So you can know what you have so that you don't walk in darkness. All right. Verse 15. Yes. He that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. I was telling this to somebody too. I think it was Tammy I was talking to. I love that. Don't judge me. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. God has given you his spirit. Praise the Lord. Who is he that is spiritual? The spirit man. The human spirit that is full of the Spirit of God.
Right.
Born again, right? Your spirit is judged by no man.
No.
Praise the Lord. Man can judge your actions, your behavior, but he can't judge your spirit.
Right.
Only God can.
Right.
Amen? And God has declared you innocent, righteous in Christ, washed, cleansed. All you need is just for your feet to get washed once in a while. Amen. To continue in that righteousness. You have to be reminded of who you are. You have to remind yourself because you're going to get judged because we got flesh and blood and we live in a real world and people are looking to judge anybody and everybody and especially Christians. Oh, but the good news is they can judge this all they want. God has already declared the reality of me, who I really am, to be righteous, holy, and pure. Therefore, I have a right to expect God's going to speak to me in my spirit and lead me and guide me. He doesn't have to come on. I don't have to have a natural understanding of it. You understand what I'm saying? He's speaking to us, and he leads us, and he guides us by the Spirit. If we will just trust him, we can walk our natural walk believing that God has lighted my path, amen, and been a lamp to my feet, and I can't go astray. Amen. Because I have the Holy Spirit who is leading me and guiding me into all truth, into more truth, into greater revelation. We ought to have more confidence when God speaks to us of, you know, I mean, what is prophecy? Edifying, uplifting, encouraging, positive. That's what prophecy is. And prophecy, Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights with whom there's no variableness nor shadow of turning. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Get over this. Relax. Just go. And if it isn't contradicting the Word of God, you have every right to believe it. You have every right to expect that God has spoken to your spirit, and you need to just let it out. You need to declare it. You need to say it. This is what we're talking about, you know, on the Friday night house of worship, you know, Eastern Gate. That's what that is. It's us getting out of the box. It's us. You, I hear you guys when I'm here. I hear you declaring. I hear you prophesying. I hear you speaking things that sound too good. They sound too big. That's God. You can't be too big for God. The promises of God are yea, and in him, amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He's just looking for somebody to declare it. Someone who feels it. Someone who hears it in their spirit and then speaks it out.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You don't have to be able to prove it.
No.
If it doesn't contradict the Word of God, you better accept it as revelation that God's trying to do something. Because His Word only produces when it doesn't come back void. So what He's saying to you, He's trying to get it into this world, and your legal body, your body in this world, gives you a legal right then to prophetically speak from the Spirit of God and bring those things to pass in this natural world. Hallelujah. Whenever we think, well, it's just somebody blowing. No, it's not. It's not. It's the Word of God being released, amen, and it changes the environment. It changes everything. And the devil, it's only natural then that the devil's going to do everything he can to throw stuff out there in the natural to cause you to question, because this doesn't ring through your ears like everything else does. You know, I mean, it's something inside. It's something internalized, and you have to become sensitive to it. The one way that you become sensitive to it is to respond to it when it happens. When it comes, you want to speak it. You want to declare it. Find somebody, amen, that will agree with you. Even if they don't agree with you, if they'll just sit there and keep quiet while you tell them. Amen? You know, the last thing you need is somebody that wants to debate it. You already got that going on with the enemy. That's what he does. He comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The moment the Word of God goes out, you can read it throughout the Gospels, the minute that God speaks into your spirit, the enemy comes immediately. Once you start to move in that area and start to declare and step out, the enemy comes immediately to try to steal that word from you, to try to convince you that didn't come from God. That was just you. You need to hear an audible voice. You need to have a vision. You got to have something tangible. You got to have. No, it ain't kind of happened that way. It might, but if it does, it's a lesser degree of God's revelation. He gave us His Spirit so that we could know what we have in God. So that it would be settled in us.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Look at 1 Corinthians 2, verse 16. Next verse down. This is what he's talking about. This is the context in which this scripture is being given. Amen. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? Now, it sounds like he's saying, like he did to Job. Job, where were you when I hung the north on nothing? I mean, you're going to give me advice? Where were you when I was doing all of this? But here's the difference. Job said, oh, I wish I could go back to the time when the candle was upon my head and the light was upon my tabernacle, where I was hearing from God. And here's the New Testament response. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? We have the mind of Christ. Not that we instruct God, but we know the mind of God. Somebody said, well, you know, let's find out what the will of God is. I'm not sure what the will of God is. It's right here. The will of God is that everybody gets healed. I'm not saying everybody gets healed. I'm saying that's the will of God. It doesn't change from one person to the next. It doesn't change based on the diagnosis. It is the will of God. Or Jesus would not have suffered those stripes that we might be healed. Amen? That is our declaration. That is our revelation. That is what we are to declare. And we declare it regardless. I have two siblings that are dead. They're in heaven, thank the Lord. But their bodies are in a grave. Amen? And I preached healing from day one, from the first day, amen, that I got born again. So that fact does not change the reality of God's Word. I don't know where their heads were and all of that and where they were able to receive. One was a Baptist, one was a kind of a, you know, free spirit, praise the Lord. I mean, he was born again, he accepted the Lord, but he never really was connected with the church. So he didn't know. He didn't have any good theology. And my sister, God bless her, she loved the Lord and she did. She spent her whole life doing things for the Lord. But her theology was Baptist. I love Baptists. I'm not against Baptists. They love the Lord. But let's face it, they don't believe in healing. They believe it's a crapshoot. Maybe God will heal and maybe God won't. Maybe God gave you that sickness to teach you something or to make you more sensitive to somebody else who has that same problem. That's not God. That is not the will of God. If it is, then Jesus suffered those stripes for absolutely nothing.
That's right.
And he would be a liar to say that by his stripes we were healed. And if he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, his word is the same as well.
Yes.
And let me just say this, not to be critical, but I just want to remind you that in Isaiah 61 that we sang, great. But that last verse that says the day of the Lord's vengeance, Jesus left out. Because
yep.
That day has not come.
Yep.
That comes after the rapture of the church. That's why Jesus didn't include it when he quoted it in Luke chapter 4, or I think it's Luke or Mark, where he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor and so forth. And he stopped short and closed the book when he came to the line that says, and the day of the vengeance of the Lord, because that day is not here.
Right.
Praise the Lord. It's not coming until we're out of here,
right,
because his vengeance has already been satisfied. His wrath has already been satisfied as far as we are concerned,
yes,
in Christ. Jesus paid the price. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So, again, I'm not being critical. I understand the song. I'm just saying, you know, sometimes we read those things and we don't pick up on the subtleties of it. And Jesus was very clear.
Right.
God's not angry.
That's
why I'm here, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord.
Right.
The year of God's acceptance.
Yes.
Amen? And it's been going on for 2,000 years now. And it will continue until the church has been raptured out of here. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, how do we have the mind of Christ? Through the Word of God in the human spirit. Praise the Lord. Because God's Spirit bears witness with our spirit.
Yes.
We are one with Christ.
Yes.
And He is the source of all knowledge. That's why David said, I'm wiser than all my teachers. Why? Because he had a higher IQ?
No.
Because he believed God. He trusted God. All right? Luke chapter 12, verse 31 through 34. Oh, let me tell you something. Y'all been being led by the Spirit, even if you don't recognize it. But the more you become sensitive to it, the more impacting you can be. If you don't think it's just an accident that you run into this person with this problem today, you know what I'm saying? Or you don't think it's just a coincidence. But this is the Spirit of God leading you and guiding you so that He can speak through you to somebody else. We are being led by the Spirit. We know it. Sometimes you're in the grocery store and you get that unction to just, you see somebody, you just want to your hand on their shoulder and say, you know, God loves you. Can I pray with you?
Yeah.
That ain't the devil. Believe me. That's not the devil trying to get you to do that.
No.
That's the Spirit of God. Amen? But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell that you have, give alms, provide yourselves bags with which wax not old, a treasure in the heavens that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. In other words, your treasure is in your heart or your spirit.
Yes. Yes.
Everything that you have need of is in you.
Yes.
How can I say that? Because is not everything that you have needed. Is not God the source?
Yes. Yes.
He's not carrying around a big bag over his back like Santa Claus. He has it. He just is it. Amen? He is our healer. He is our provider. He is our deliverer. That's what he is.
Yes.
And you have him living in your spirit.
Yes.
So your treasure is right here.
Yes.
It's right in you. Everything you have need of, healing, deliverance, prosperity, amen, wholeness, oneness, it's all there. It's already here. It's provided for us because he went to the cross and sent back the Holy Spirit to be in us, not just with us or on us, but to be in us, so that we didn't have to go and beg and plead, but to believe that we already have it and declare it.
Yes.
That's a witness. His spirit with your spirit. Praise the Lord. Verse 35. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. Praise the Lord. I love it when he does that. The Word of God is the truth. And we know from Ephesians that it's the truth that we are girded with. Right? The light he's referring to is your spirit. Have the truth and be led by the Spirit.
Yeah.
And you know what will happen? Your light will shine.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Proverbs 13 and 9. Remember the scripture talks about, you know, in the last days, darkness, gross darkness will be upon the land, but the light of God will shine brighter. Amen. The light of the righteous rejoiceth, but the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. Amen. The world is more confused than it's ever been, at least in my lifetime. I mean, I watch the news and I'm thinking, what are these people thinking? I mean, how can they even say these things? I mean, how can they even believe? But they do, praise the Lord. So they're confused. But look at Proverbs 11 and 8. So the righteous rejoiceth, but the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. The righteous is delivered out of trouble, and the wicked cometh instead. In his stead. We're delivered, they're left. They're still there. Amen. The light is the revelation. The light is the understanding. It's the kingdom of light. The kingdom of the Spirit, in other words. Our spirits have been made alive to God, alighted. They've been enlightened. Right?
Yes.
The lost are in a kingdom of darkness. Why? Because they have a human spirit, but it's not enlightened.
Right.
It's in darkness because it is not connected to God.
Right.
They cannot be led by the Spirit. No wonder they're in confusion.
Yeah.
What is the scripture even says? What was right is wrong. What was wrong is now right.
Yeah.
And everybody's saying, yeah, that's the way it ought to be. And you're thinking, what world, what planet are they living on that they don't know? What has changed in 25 years or 40 years or 50 years that all of a sudden what was right is no longer right?
Yeah.
It's only natural because we've been enlightened and they're in darkness.
Right.
Praise the Lord. The world is more confused, but the righteous will grow in wisdom and understanding of God's ways. And that is what I believe is happening right now in this church.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. We're learning that God is speaking to us all the time. And we're trying to divorce ourselves, disassociate ourselves from the natural way of doing church.
Right.
From the natural way of living our lives.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We're becoming enlightened.
Yes.
More and more with each day. Amen. Because we're getting closer to the time of great darkness. And when there's great darkness, which is already upon the land but hasn't totally overwhelmed it, not just America, I'm not just talking about the United States, I'm talking about the whole world is in darkness. But he said that in that day, something's going to happen in my church, in my body. And that light is going to shine. That revelation, that reality, that truth is going to shine, and it's going to shine so bright that it will even overtake all of the darkness.
Yes.
Praise
yes.
the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Adam was created by God, amen, and put on the earth. His spirit was enlightened. We know it was because he walked and talked with God. He had a connection. There was an awareness, a revelation of God. Amen. His spirit was enlightened. But when he ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil,
right.
See, he had only known good.
That's right.
He only knew innocence.
Yes.
praise the Lord, the moment he got that mixture of good and evil, he was in darkness. Praise the Lord. He was operating totally by his senses from that point on. Look at Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. The second Adam has come. And he paid the price for the first Adam and all that would follow.
Amen.
And what happened? When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting.
Yep.
And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of light, fire, and it set upon each of them. Now, it didn't just set there, because they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. That's the birth of the church. That's being led by the Spirit. That's being sensitive to the Holy Spirit and operating by that Spirit. It never happened before. They had a vague understanding based on what Jesus had told them, but they didn't have the Holy Spirit before that, so they didn't really understand how it was going to happen or what it was going to be when it happened. And what did they do after that? They just went out and turned the world upside down. These are not educated people. These are not seminarians. They don't have a degree in theology. They had the Spirit of God to lead them and to guide them. And they operated in the supernatural. Because they believed what God said, and they operated by that unction of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Amen? That, friends, is grace.
Amen.
Yes. Amen? And by grace, we've been enlightened in order to be a light. Amen? We'll close with this. Proverbs chapter 4, verses 18 through 23. Proverbs 4, 18 through 23. But the path of the just is as the shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. The way of the wicked is as darkness. They know not at what they stumble. My son, attend to my words, incline thine ears, my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes, keep them in the midst of thine heart. For they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Keep your heart, keep your spirit with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Praise the Lord. Everything that you have need of is already right here. Jesus said, the water that I've come to give you, if you drink of it, you'll never thirst again. And out of your spirit, out of your inner man, out of your born-again man, will flow rivers of living water. Out of you will flow the Spirit of God.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That is what God intends for the church.
Yes.
Don't let anybody laugh you or mock you out of speaking out what God places in your spirit. If they don't get it, just move on.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. Don't worry about it. You stand on the words, on the sense of what God is telling you. Look, it's like some of you may be familiar with this and some others may not, but tongues and interpretation. It's called interpretation because it's not a translation. Amen?
Right.
So I may give a word of tongues, a message in tongues. Tim may interpret it.
Mm-hmm.
My message may last 30 seconds.
Right.
His interpretation may take 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. But it does not make it not true.
Right.
Because the Spirit interprets. Amen. As we release it, and as he receives it in his spirit, then he just speaks out what comes to him.
Right.
He doesn't hear. I mean, what he heard can't be translated because there's no translation for it.
Right.
I mean, we don't have an ABCs. We don't have vowels. We don't have consonants. We don't have the, you know, the post, past, pre. You know, you're just there.
Yeah.
So you just respond. That was one of the things that I learned more out of that than anything else when it comes to being led by the Spirit.
Yes.
You'll just feel this, because I know this, I don't want to be identified. You know, I've been in church services, and I remember one of the first times I gave an interpretation was in Ames at a UPC church up there. I'll tell you, you'll never find anybody more critical, amen, of interpretations of tongues or prophetic words than Pentecostals. Because they all think it's not smoke unless it's coming out of their chimney. Praise the Lord. I'm using a lot of generalities here. I'm just kidding. But there are, you know that. I mean, they are very quick to say, I'm discerning something that's just, that ain't right. That ain't right. Well, that's, you know, fine. But I'm saying, my point was this. I didn't want to give the interpretation.
Right.
But nobody else did. And I felt it so strong that I felt like if I don't, it's worse than making a fool out of myself by doing it. Because I'd never done it before, and I didn't know what to expect. I'm wanting to hear words. But I never heard any words. I just had a feeling and an idea of the direction God was trying to go. And once I started speaking, it just came right out. I knew it was the Lord because I felt totally at peace about it as soon as I did it. Amen? Now, whether anybody else accepted it or not was not my problem. It wasn't my job to convince everybody. My responsibility was to respond to what the Spirit was leading me to do. And it's that simple for everything that we do when it comes to being led by the Spirit of God. God is not afraid of you being bold or of you taking a risk and saying, I think this is the Lord. Because if it's not contradicting this, you're not going to get hurt. It's not going to be a bad thing. Take a chance. Trust the Lord. Believe. Have confidence in that Spirit that is in you. He gave it to you for more than just a ticket out of here. He gave it to you so that you can dominate here, so that you can rule and reign, so that you can have subdue and operate in the position of kings and priests in this world.
Yes.
And you know that when a king speaks, it's done.
Yes.
Amen? When you declare it in agreement with God, it's a done deal. It has to come to pass. It can't be undone. And God is just standing up there going, if I can kind of humanize him here just a little bit, but he's standing up there just waiting for someone to say back what he has spoken so that his word that is settled in heaven will be settled on earth. That's what Jesus' prayer was all about. Not that we would just have a rote, repetitious kind of prayer, but that we would pray that his kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. And the way we do that is by declaring, by responding to the unction of the Holy Spirit in each one of us. When God gives you a sense of, I want you to do this, or go here, or speak this, or this is what I want to do for you, man, shout it out.
Yes.
Speak it out. Speak it back to God. Let the angel see that there's people here that have faith. Jesus said, when I come, will I find faith? If he knows he will.
Yes.
He's saying that for our benefit. Because it doesn't take faith to just say something theological. It takes faith to say what God has spoken to you that you can't find word for word verbatim in the Bible. But you'll know because his Spirit bears witness with your spirit that this is God's word. This is the mind of Christ speaking through you. You say, praise the Lord? That's why we ought to be bold. The closer we get to the darker times, the bolder we ought to get so our light shines all the brighter. Amen? Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Your spirit is the candle of the Lord. And he lit it up on the day of Pentecost. And the moment you got born again, he put the bick to it. And you've been burning ever since. Praise the Lord. So let's burn him down. Hallelujah. Praise God. God bless everybody. Thanks for being here. You're dismissed. Go out there and be supernatural. That's what you are. Hallelujah. Have a great rest of the week. Lord bless you.